Good evening. I'm glad you could stop by.
Good evening, Clay. You wanted to see me?
I just want to share this article I ran into at KIK Knowledge is King. Interesting post.
What's the name of the post?
The Great Divide. The story of Nathaniel Bacon's rebellion. It was posted by Teresa Odom Sanders. Here, let me read it to you. Nathaniel Bacon was a white property owner in Jamestown, Virginia, who managed to unite slaves, indentured servants and poor whites in a revolutionary effort to overthrow the planter elite. Although slaves clearly occupied the lowest position in the social hierarchy, and suffered the most under the plantation system, the condition of indentured whites was barely better, and the majority of free whites lived in extreme poverty, as explained by historian Edmund Morgan. In colonies like Virginia, the planter elite, with huge land grants, occupied a vastly superior position to workers of all colors. Southern colonies did not hesitate to invent ways to extend the terms of servitude, and the planter class accumulated uncultivated lands to restrict the options of free workers. The simmering resentment against the planter class created conditions that were ripe for revolt. Varying accounts of Bacon's rebellion abound, but the basic facts are these. Bacon developed plans in 1675 to seize Native American lands in order to acquire more property for himself and others and nullify the threat of Indian raids. When the planter elite in Virginia refused to provide militia support for this scheme, Bacon retaliated, leading an attack on the elite, their homes, and their property. He openly condemned the rich for their oppression of the poor and inspired an alliance of white and black bond laborers, as well as slaves, who demanded an end to their servitude. The attempted revolution was ended by force and false promises of amnesty. A number of the people who participated in the revolt were hanged. The events in Jamestown were alarming to the planter elite, who were deeply fearful of the multiracial alliance of bond workers and slaves. Word of Bacon's rebellion spread far and wide, and several more uprisings of a similar type followed. The events in Jamestown were alarming to the planter elite, who were deeply fearful of the multiracial alliance of bond workers and slaves. Word of Bacon's rebellion spread far and wide, and several more uprisings of a similar type followed. In an effort to protect their superior status and economic position, the planters shifted their strategy for maintaining dominance. They abandoned their heavy reliance on indentured servants in favor of the importation of more black slaves. Instead of importing English-speaking slaves from the West Indies, who were more likely to be familiar with European language and culture, many more slaves were shipped directly from Africa. These slaves would be far easier to control and far less likely to form alliances with poor whites. Fearful that such measures might not be sufficient to protect their interest, the planter class took an additional precautionary step, a step that would later come to be known as a racial bribe. Deliberately and strategically, the planter class extended special privileges to poor whites in an effort to drive a wedge between them and black slaves. White settlers were allowed to police slaves through slave patrols and militias, and barriers were created so that free labor would not be placed in competition with slave labor. These measures effectively eliminated the risk of future alliances between black slaves and poor whites. Poor whites suddenly had a direct, personal stake in the existence of a race-based system of slavery. Their own plight had not improved by much, but at least they were not slaves. Once the planters' elite split the labor force, poor whites responded to the logic of their situation and sought ways to expand their racially privileged position. By the mid-1770s, the system of bond labor had been thoroughly transformed into a racial caste system predicated on slavery. The degraded status of Africans was justified on the ground that Negroes, like the Indians, was an uncivilized lesser race, perhaps even more lacking in intelligence and laudable human qualities than the red-skinned natives. The notion of white supremacy rationalized the enslavement of Africans, even as whites endeavored to form a new nation based on the ideals of equality, liberty, and justice for all. Before democracy, chattel slavery in America was born. That's it. What do you think?
This is a prime example of how race is used to control the masses. Race is a man-made illusion, no doubt. Whites are the greatest victims of white supremacy because it has moved them the furthest away from reality, and that reality is revealed in Allah's book. The Quran. The surah is Al-Hujurat, the rooms. O mankind, indeed we have created you from male and female and made you peoples and tribes, not race, that you may know one another. Indeed, the most noble of you in the sight of Allah is the most righteous of you. Indeed, Allah is knowing and acquainted. The day we, collectively, see white supremacy for what it is, an illusion, that will be the day shackles will fall from many of our brains, and that also includes those that are in combat against the perception. We only battle ourselves when you think you're battling something that's not real. Live for what is real, and all things that are fabricated will fall in place, and all things that appears to be major racial problems will dissolve because its backing will not exist. Reacting to an illusion with a greater illusion will only enhance our problems. White supremacy is not a wall, because walls are built with concrete and concrete is rock solid. White supremacy, or in that matter any race or tribal supremacy, is built with illusions and perceptions. Real history show this. Let's rid ourselves from the notion that we must cross over what is not real. We can simply just walk right through it because, once again, illusion and deceptions are not concrete. New minds must be in order to pull this off.
So you believe whites are superior to all other racial groups because they're white? Do you believe that dark-skinned people are inferior to whites because of their dark skin? You can't believe in one without believing in the other. White supremacy's power comes from the mentality the white people's power is solely genetic, and I am not buying that. I understand that it may appear that they're in control, but what you see is just a mirror. If you believe that someone is greater than you because of the color of their skin, you'll never reach the full potential that you were blessed with. The belief in racial supremacy is only used when various elites want to put people in a particular pecking order to control the masses. They put those that has the same skin complexion as them and use them mainly to protect the system that they would like to implement. Racial supremacy is a man-made illusion, and any submission to it suppressed the subconscious mind of the alleged victims of it.
It's an insult to the one that blew life into your physical body. God did not create any person to serve anyone other than himself. Give in to the notion of any racial supremacy and it will be your reality. Remember, the only power a lie has is your belief in it.
K.I.K. Knowledge is king.
Get into the know.
K.I.K. was designed to bring attention to issues and historical events that are rarely talked about in mainstream America. Check it out. Membership is free. Peace.
Peace.